Next up, we are talking civil society again with a specific view on peace work. And we have Kaisu Kinnunen here to give us a presentation. So, Kaisu, why don't you tell us who you are, and I'll give you the floor.
Thank you. I hope everybody can hear me loud and clear. Good. My name is Kaisu Kinnunen. I am currently the chair of a peace organization named Committee of 100 in Finland. So that's my connection to peace work. And I represent myself here, and I appreciate being Finland inviting me to write an article to this pamphlet. And in my article, I looked into the questions of how UBI helps contribute to peace and peace work from two perspectives. First, to better understand how income and income security, to be more specific, is connected to peace, I think it's important to talk about the broader concept of peace, where peace is understood as something more than just an absence of war. And secondly, I look into peace work done by civil society, which relies strongly on voluntary work. And I try to elaborate how UBI can provide opportunities also for peace work. And I see this as an important point of view, especially on the Nordic context, given our region's long history in volunteer work. But yeah, as I see it, basic income as a sufficient livelihood can in itself work as a basis for sustainable peace. We know, following countless of studies, that steady income creates sense of security, which is a basic human need, and that the risk of violent or armed conflict rises with difficult economic situation or poverty. Additionally, social exclusion and lack of participation in society may result in dissatisfaction and violence, which are the root causes of conflicts. While also the equality of opportunities and a fair distribution of resources contribute to peace, and especially to sustainable peace. And when we talk about sustainable peace, we talk about a stable state of peace where everyone has possibilities to participate and be themselves without fear of violence or exclusion. This is promoted, or let's say that this sustainable peace is created by promoting positive peace. This term is introduced by a Norwegian researcher, Johan Galtung, and basically positive peace is a desired state where disagreements are resolved without violence, and peace and cooperation are promoted by addressing the root causes of conflicts. For example, as I mentioned earlier, conflicts are likely to occur when people's livelihoods are endangered or distribution of resources in society is unfairly organized, and economic conditions are actually the main causes of armed conflicts. So this is why we need to address these issues if we want to maintain peace. And this in mind, positive and sustainable peace includes, for example, equal opportunities for influence and the safeguarding and realization of human rights and people's basic needs. And it is also defined through functioning institutions, norms, and attitudes. As many of us here know, Nordic welfare states are often described through these same pillars as here. So basically, in a peaceful society, people's basic needs and well-being are taken well into account, and resources, such as income, are distributed equally. And sustainable economic and social development is here the best guarantee for maintaining peace. Also, in a peaceful society, social and political change is achieved using peaceful means, so no violence, and also by avoiding use of physical or armed force against other people, which is always, this always affects societies in harmful ways. And I mean here that preventing violence is a better choice than dealing with the consequences. And this is what peace work is for. We promote peaceful change and seek to remove structures that create violence. And one way to do this is by giving people opportunities to participate in meaningful activities. And civil society actually has a major role in promoting peace, in addition to international organizations and states. We know that many international disarmament treaties and agreements are actually a result of civil society's long-term campaigning, and this goes to show the importance of non-governmental and non-profit organizations' role in peace building. And this in mind, in Nordic countries, we have a long history in voluntary activities, which also connects people to decision makers, to politicians, and actually in Europe, the Nordic countries rank the highest in the measure of the proportion of the population working voluntarily. So that's a good thing. But today, we are seeing that this is actually changing. And it may imply that people need to work harder to earn their sufficient livelihood. They don't have enough time to do or participate in voluntary work in civil society's activities. And this decrease in participation may result in weaker sense of belonging, loss of the relatively high level of trust we have here in the Nordic region. And these both are built with close relations between civil society and politicians. And peace is actually also built through trust, be it our trust in institutions or trust between states and people. High trust benefits us economically and socially. People are happier, crime is lower, and people are more inclined to participate in creating common good. So we can see trust as a key element in a peaceful and well-functioning society. I think everyone here or everyone participating in this pamphlet agrees that cooperation in the Nordic countries is something that we shouldn't let quietly fade away. And I dare to claim that the Nordic region could set an example and be the kind of superstars of participation, political engagement, and giving people freedom to pursue peace or other dreams. We are the happiest societies in the world, according to World Happiness Report. We have high level of trust, and we have all the resources to contribute to the common good of humanity. And at our current times, especially in the light of new global security concerns and growing economic insecurity, I think it is crucial for the Nordic welfare states also to evolve to ensure positive development and to reform our systems to better protect basic human needs. And as I see it, and as I wrote in my article, UBI might be the most simple and effective solution. So if I still have time to conclude, the ability to rely on a secure income allows for everyone to focus their efforts in building peaceful society, and UBI would be one solution to this direction. Thank you.